When you prepare a model for 3D printing, you'll always need to choose an infill structure for your part. Since current slicers give you the option of choosing between a whole lot, you might have already been asking yourself which one is the strongest and most suitable for your application. So in today's video, we'll crush some test samples to find out which performs the best, and I was especially interested in the much hyped Jarroid infill you might have already heard of. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan, and welcome to CNC Kitchen. In a previous video, I've already been taking a look at the strength of different infill structures that you can find in Simplify 3D, and also talked about why it's more efficient in many cases if you increase the number of perimeters instead of increasing the infill percentage. If you haven't seen it yet, there's a link in the description. I wanted to do a bit more research in this direction and especially find out how different patterns behave in different directions. Because often you can't orientate your part in a way that it's perfect for the chosen infill. In addition, Slicer Prusa Edition features three-dimensional infill structures, most prominently Gyroid infill, that claim to have more isotropic, so more uniform strength behavior in all loading directions. In order to perform the tests for this video, I had to adapt my tensile testing machine to be able to perform the compression tests. If you're interested in the machining process on my CNC, there's also a link in the description to that video. I've been thinking quite a while for a suitable test specimen. At first, I thought of just printing the infill pattern without any exterior walls, but since the infill in your parts will always be surrounded by a shell of material which is reinforcing the structure, I ended up printing cubes of 22mm side length that use one perimeter and two top and bottom layers at 0.15mm layer height, which results in a constant wall thickness of 0.45mm. This gave me the possibility to use the same specimens for the tests where I crushed the blocks from the top as well as from the side and therefore make the results more comparable. I'm well aware that this shell will add additional strength to the structure, so we are not purely testing the infill, but since it is the same for all, we can still compare the results. I haven't tested all of the patterns available and tried to concentrate on the, in my opinion, most relevant ones, which are rectilinear, grid, triangle, cubic, line, honeycomb, 3D honeycomb and gyroid. The way how the parts will probably fail on such a compression test is usually not compressive yielding of the structures, but the stability failure buckling of a wall, which then leads to more load on the rest of the part and therefore fatal failure. The shape of the infill or even how the infill supports the external shell will determine how and at what load the structure fails. The slenderness of the structure will play a huge role and curved structures like, for example in the gyroid, will act like ribbing and improve the strength. I am a little bit limited on my testing machine because it unfortunately stalls at around 3.5 kN or 340 kg of load, so I only used an infill ratio of 10%. Unfortunately, as I already talked about in a previous video, 10% infill does not result in the same amount of material used for each of the samples. Most notably, the part with 10% 3D honeycomb infill weighs almost double the one with 10% rectilinear infill. Either that's a bug or the generation algorithm is really strange. Anyway, so at first I printed a batch of samples, all at 10%, weighed them and then adjusted the infill ratio slightly so that all samples roughly weighed the same in the end that I use for testing. Before we take a look at the strength of infill patterns, let's at first take a look at the printing time because this is something that is also well relevant. Most of the infill patterns take around the same amount of time to print, only the honeycomb structures take way longer due to the constant change of print direction, where the printhead has to accelerate and decelerate constantly, which wastes a lot of time. Also, I have the fear that my printer rattles itself apart after a while when I use these patterns. Interestingly, the gyroid infill that also consists out of a lot of turns doesn't take much longer to print than the other more standard patterns due to the nice smooth turns that the printhead does, where accelerations are much smoother, so a kind of constant line velocity can be kept. I printed all of the samples in Form Futura's premium PLA on my original Prusa i3 Mark IIs. Now let's come to the destructive tests. I've been testing each pattern once in the build direction and once from the side. Let's start with the pattern I mostly use for my prints, which is the rectilinear infill. The first sample failed at 309 kg of load, whereas if you load it from the side, it was only able to bear 191 kg, which is almost 40% less. Keep in mind that these samples are only 22 mm in each dimension, so this amount of load is already quite impressive. Unfortunately, the cubes of the grid, triangle, line and honeycomb patterns were too much for my machine and it stalled for all of them at around 350 kg of load. Taking a look at the samples still already showed that they were just before failure because the outer walls already showed buckling marks. So for these samples we don't really have the exact value to compare against, but if we still look at the transverse strength, the other loading direction is at least 30 to 45% weaker. The interesting results are now for the 3D infill patterns, where all performed very comparable in the Z direction. If we also take a look at the strength, 90 degrees rotated, cubic and gyroid infill perform exactly the same just as claimed, only the 3D honeycomb performs about 15% worse. So which is now the best infill you can choose? Well, that depends. I'm still a huge fan of rectilinear infill if your parts don't require a huge amount of strength. It prints almost the fastest and it's the infill that has the densest structure, which is great for your top layers, so reduces pillowing, even at low infill ratios. If we take a look at the numbers, the line infill patterns might even be better since it has higher strength values, prints faster and the infill spacing is almost as dense as with rectilinear. If you have a part that is purely loaded in compression, honeycomb might still be the way to go, but prints quite long and might rattle your printer apart. Triangle infill might be an alternative, maybe a little bit weaker, but prints much faster. For the 3D infill patterns, 3D honeycomb is dead in my opinion. Cubic and gyroid infill performs pretty much the same, just the infill spacing is a little denser with the new contestant, and come on, it definitely looks cooler. So in summary, I probably might be using line infill for any aesthetic parts and anything that will see some load, gyroid infill might be the new way to go due to its good and uniform strength in all directions. Now I'd really like to know from you guys if I've missed something and which investigation you'd really like to see in the future. Just leave a comment down below. I hope you liked the video and learned something. Please leave a thumbs up. I spent quite a lot of time on my research, so if you want to support the making of these videos, then consider becoming a Patreon and take a look at the affiliate links down in the description. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't yet and take a look at the other videos. Thanks for watching, auf Wiedersehen, and I hope to see you around next time.